We are the Strong Minor Project, proudly present to you Connect with three international speakers. Mufti Ismail Meng from Zimbabwe.
But do it respectfully. You can stand up and ask and demand for what is yours, but do it respectfully.
Dr. Muhammad Salah from Egypt.
Most of all, except الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر.
And Sheikh Wael Ibrahim from Australia.
To unwanted behavior, to someone who's asking for a haram. He didn't shout at him telling him, don't you know who am I? Don't you know that it is haram?
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. ما شاء الله، اللهم بارك، اللهم بارك، اللهم بارك. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله وكفى، وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. All praises due to Allah alone. We praise him and we seek his help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, none can show him guidance. May the greatest peace and salutations be upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allow me to begin by saying, I thank the Almighty Allah a lot for bringing me here and for giving me the opportunity to see these beautiful faces and this beautiful country of yours. Then thank you, brothers and sisters, for the great hospitality and seeing this beautiful masjid and knowing from the founders that this masjid is named Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and also the doors are named after the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is inspiring. That's why I have to change my topic slightly, because I'm in the masjid of Muhammad. I'm surrounded with the gates of Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, and Ali. Radiyallahu anhum ajma'in. So we'll be talking about the love of Rasulullah Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallama tasliman kathira, insha'Allah. One day, Anas ibn Malik, one of the great companions of Rasulullah, peace be upon him, said, we finished the prayer and I was leaving the masjid along with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At the door of the masjid, a Bedouin stopped the Prophet, peace be upon him, and he asked him a question. He said, O Prophet of Allah, when is the day of judgment? This question is normally asked by the kuffar to challenge not only Prophet Muhammad but all the prophets before. They say, when is the day of judgment? They keep warning us about the day of judgment. Bring it on. When is it going to take place? We're not afraid of it. But this Bedouin is coming from a different angle. He said, when is the day of judgment? When will it take place? When will Allah the Almighty resurrect all of us for reckoning? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, instead of answering him like he normally answers, and he says, عِلْمُهَا عِنْدَ رَبِّي لَا يُجَلِّيهَا لِوَقْتِهَا إِلَّهُ. Only Allah knows when will the day of judgment take place. And that is stated in the Quran repeatedly. Instead of that, he asked him a question. When he said, when is the day of judgment? He said, what have you prepared for it? Are you ready for it? So the Bedouin said, well, O Prophet of Allah, I haven't done much of good deeds. I haven't done much of prayers or fasting or charity, but I love Allah and His Messenger from the bottom of my heart. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked at him and said, well, then on the day of judgment, you will be in the company of those whom you love. Who heard that? Anas ibn Malik. What did he say and what was he comment on this answer of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Anta ma'a man ahbabt. On the day of judgment, you will be gathered with those whom you love. So Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu said, by Allah, there was no better news to us after accepting Islam than this news. Then what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam answered al-A'rabi or the Bedouin with, that by mere loving the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you will be saved. Not only that, you will be gathered with him in Jannah, in al-Firdaws al-A'la. So loving the messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, is one of the greatest deeds which Allah loves and appreciates. Truly loving Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will escort you to heaven and will guarantee you salvation on the day of judgment. Then when Abu Dharr al-Ghifari radiyallahu anhu heard about this statement, so he visited the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I have a question. What do you think of a man who has good company, but he is not as good as them? He cannot catch up with their good deeds. What will happen to him? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam understood what Abu Dharr al-Ghifari is aiming at. And he said, Ya Abu Dharr, anta ma'a man ahbabt. You will be with those whom you love. Abu Dharr al-Ghifari was a great companion. But no matter how great were the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, none of them perceived themselves as good as the Prophet. And that's why they were worried. There was a Sahabi by the name Thawban, always seeing the Prophet ﷺ back and forth, visiting him, serving him. And then one day, every time the Prophet ﷺ sees him, he's upset. He's depressed. He's not happy. He said, what is the matter with you? He said, Ya Rasulullah, whenever I miss you, I come to the masjid. Once I lay my eyes on you, I feel better. Once I see you, I feel happy. Then whenever I remember that one day you will die, and eventually I will die, then on the day of judgment, I'm not sure whether I will have the same access of seeing you as often, because you'll be up there in al-Firdaws al-A'la. What can I do? And this is what is upsetting me. This is what is depressing me. So the Almighty Allah revealed ayah number 69, chapter number 4 of Surah An-Nisa, which says, and this ayah is not only for Thawban. And this ayah is not only for Abu Dharr al-Ghifari or for the Badwin. This is for all of us. The ayah reads as, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا ذلك الفضل من الله وكفى بالله عليما. The ayah means whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, they will be gathered in the company of all the prophets, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa Ibrahim, wa Musa, wa Ismail, wa Hud, wa Nuh, wa Adam. All of them will be in al-Firdaws al-A'la. What is al-Firdaws al-A'la? We hear this word a lot. In the hadith, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when you guys invoke Allah for heaven, when you say, oh Allah, take me to heaven, don't settle for the least. You know, some people say, I don't mind, even if I enter the basement of Jannah. You know, even if I just crawl, it doesn't matter. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaches us to aim high, to be in the best place. So he said, whenever you ask Allah for heaven, you should ask Him for the highest place, which is Al-Firdaus Al-A'la. Right on top of Al-Firdaus Al-A'la is the throne of the Almighty Allah. Above you is Allah. Nothing is above you but the Almighty Allah. فَسَقْفُهُ عَرْشُ الرَّحْمَنِ. So the company of the prophets, الصديقين, the verifiers of the truth, on top of whom will be Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. Which gate is the gate of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq? This one? MashaAllah. I love Abu Bakr al-Siddiq dearly, more than anyone else. I do love all the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but Abu Bakr al-Siddiq is a very special one. والصديقين والشهداء and the martyrs والصالحين and all the righteous ones, and how excellent will be such company. So what do I do in order to get there? Just obey Allah and His Messenger. You know, in one hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Oh my Ummah, shall enter paradise." Alhamdulillah, good news. Listen. Except those who refuse, stand up again. They say, "Ya Rasulullah, and who will refuse to enter heaven?" Here is a tricky point. He said, "Man ata'ani dakhala al-jannah, wa man 'asani faqad aba." Whoever obeys me will enter Jannah. And whoever disobeys me, he or she have refused, have chosen not to enter Jannah. It's their choice. You already have the key, which is La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. To turn it, in order to unlock the lock to enter Jannah, you got to obey Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. من أطعني دخل الجنة ومن عصاني فقد أبى. You neglect His orders. You neglect His sunnah. You change, you innovate in the deen of Allah, and you assume that you're better than the Prophet? Not a chance. Not a chance. He said, follow and do not innovate. Isn't the deen complete? Isn't it? Do you ever think that the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died without delivering the message fully? No, he didn't. Allah the Almighty said, in an ayah of Surah Al-Ma'idah, chapter number 5, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا. In Arabic we say, خَلَاص. Do you have that word in your language as well? خَلَاص means what? Over. Finished. Message is complete. There is no room for more to add. The deen is complete. Sharia is perfect. No one after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have died have the right to add to it anything. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the most honest, and he has delivered the message complete. Today I have completed the religion for you, perfected my favor upon you, and I'm pleased with Islam as your religion. Allah said so. And this ayah was revealed on Friday, which was Yawmul Hajj, the day of Arafah. A few days after Hajj, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away. So if any ordinary Muslim wants to be with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Al-Firdaus Al-A'la, in Al-Jannah, it's easy and affordable. Because in our religion, there is no hidden. There is no certain acts or verses or statements only for certain kind of people or for the elite. This is for everyone. And we're all invited to compete with one another, to race in order to achieve this high status, to be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Jannah. وَسَارِعُوا سابقوا إن سورة آل عمران، إن سورة الحديد، إن سورة المطففين، وفي ذلك فليتنافس المتنافسون. The messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, didn't hide anything from us. You follow his sunnah, you get the green card. You enter al-Jannah safely by the grace of Allah. So, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ وَحَاسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا. How excellent will be such company that you will get to see the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم day and night, morning and evening. You'll be actually living with him. You'll be living with him in Al-Firdaws Al-A'la. May Allah make us all among them. But that has a price. Only for those who can afford the price. In the sound hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَلَا إِنَّ سِلْعَةَ اللَّهِ غَالِيَةً أَلَا إِنَّ سِلْعَةَ اللَّهِ الْجَنَّةِ. Indeed, the commodity of Allah is very valuable, very expensive. Because indeed it is paradise. You want to enter it? You have to offer the price. What is the price? يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. To obey Allah and His Messenger as He prescribed, not as you wish, not as you think, not as you invent. Yani, during the life of the Prophet ﷺ, and you all know how much they loved him. Three companions were worried that they might not make it to Al-Firdaws Al-A'la with the Prophet. So they decided to find out, what does the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do in private at night? So they went to his wives one after another, and they inquired about his private worship. And then when they collected the data that they wanted, they discussed it among themselves, and they came up with the following. They said, look, by the end, he is the Prophet of Allah and he is guaranteed to enter Jannah. Not only that, in the sound hadith, that no one shall set a foot in heaven before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So one of them decided, well, I gotta do something special. I gotta do something different, more. So he said, look, I'm going to fast on every single day. They knew that the Prophet ﷺ would fast on Mondays and on Thursdays and 13th and 14th and 15th. So this is like what? 8 days plus three, 11. They said, I can do more. What are you going to do? 30 days out of the 30 days. 12 months out of the 12 months. Fasting. Thank you, mashallah. You're a hero. And the second said, oh, okay, you got this one. As for me, I'm going to pray on every single night. From Isha till Fajr. No sleep at night. That's a vow that he took upon himself. And the third, he said, as for me, I'm going to get married. Why not? You know, marriage, love, affection, sex, children will keep you busy from the love of Allah and His Messenger and worship. I don't want any of that. I will become a monk. The news reached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Before I tell you what he did and how he reacted, I'm going to ask you a question. Do you ever doubt the sincerity of these three companions? No. The lovely companions, they only wanted good things. They wanted to be with the Prophet in Jannah. And is extra fasting something praiseworthy or not praiseworthy? Praying at night is the honor of the believer. Marriage could be permissible, could be obligatory, depending on your condition. If you don't want to get married, you don't want to, no problem. But the Prophet ﷺ didn't like what they have vowed and what they've decided. So he gathered the whole ummah and started addressing them, saying, Listen to this. By Allah, إِنِّي لِأَحَبُّكُمْ لِلَّهِ وَأَتْقَاكُمْ لَهِ. Indeed, I'm the dearest and the most beloved of all of you to Allah. I'm the most righteous of all of you and the most God-fearing. Yet, I fast some days and I skip some other days. I take a break. I pray at night and I also go to sleep and rest. And I'm married. And whoever turns away from my sunnah doesn't belong to me. If you think that he can do better than the Prophet ﷺ, you're greatly mistaken. If you think that you can set your foot in Jannah before Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, then you don't get it. If you think you can invent a way better than what the Prophet ﷺ prescribed, shortcut to Jannah, then you're dreaming. You don't understand the message of Islam. So they retreated. They repented. Even though their intention was good, but they recognized that they were doing something wrong. He said, follow and do not innovate. That is the way to enter Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't prescribe anything upon his servants that they cannot afford. Subhanallah. When the messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever you hear his name, you gotta say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You wanna be with him in al-Firdaws al-A'la? Then increase, send in the peace and the blessings upon him. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He entered the masjid, you see these two poles? He saw a rope was stretched between them. He says, what is this? Is this for laundry or what? They said, no, it belongs to your wife, Zainab. She's a great worshiper. What does she do with it? Yani, when everybody goes to sleep, she comes to the masjid and she keeps standing in the night prayer until she feels sleepy, weary, and tired. So instead of going to sleep, she hangs on the rope to keep standing in the prayer. Allahu Akbar, mashallah, what a great worshipper. No, the Prophet didn't say so. Didn't applaud Zainab. Didn't say, wow, she's the best of my wives. Didn't say any of that. He said, hello, untie that rope. Remove it. Why? He said, لِيُصَلِّ أَحَدُكُمْ نَشْرَطَهُ فَإِذَا فَتَرَ فَلْيَرْقُدْ. One of you should pray as long as you feel awake and fresh. But if you're asleep, go to sleep. How good is it when you recite something you don't know what you're reciting? When you're prostrating yourself and instead of praying for yourself, you pray against yourself because you don't know what you're saying. Right? لِيُصَلِّ أَحَدُكُمْ نَشَاطَهُ اِكْلَفُوا مِنَ الْأَعْمَالِ مَا تُطِيقُونَ. Do what you can afford. Do not go beyond the limits. Do not push yourself to the edge. You will end up losing it. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَمَلُّ حَتَّى تَمَلُّ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Allah the Almighty described them in ayah number 107 of Surah Al-Anbiya, what did he say? Who remembers this ayah? Anyone? Anyone? You all gotta remember ayah number 107 of Surah Al-Anbiya. What does it say? Anyone? Anyone of the sisters? How can't you know this ayah? وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We have not sent you but as mercy. For whom? For everything that exists. For everything that exists. Ya Rasulullah, right now, we're in Bali, and this is a tourism city. And all of us, not only want to enter Jannah, we want to be with you in Jannah. One of the great scholars and tabi'een was asked, can you describe heaven for us? He said, sure, fiha Rasulullah. You know, they expected him to say about the cushions and about the food and about the rivers and about the, you know, the drink and the wine. He said, no, Rasulullah is in it. That's it. It is more than enough to know that when you enter Jannah, you'll get to meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Fiha Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's an enough joy and delight. Allahu Akbar. So, we are in this time and this place, we're living through a lot of fitan, trials, tests, temptations, a lot of challenges. We're not like the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The companions who were very pure, very obedient, they were competing. Their problem was somebody wants to fast on every single day. Our problem is we are, you know, facing the challenge of fasting during Ramadan, praying the 5 daily prayers. So what are we going to do? Listen to this hadith because we're running out of time. Anas ibn Malik and Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab and Abu Tha'alab al-Khushani, many companions narrated this hadith, and it's a sound hadith. And this hadith is the greatest good news you will ever receive. So pay close attention. It begins with that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to his companions that a while later, after I die and after you leave, there will be a time where holding fast on your religion will be similar to holding on a burning coal. It will be very hard. It will not be easy to practice your religion. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, but those who still adhere to the deen of Allah and practice properly the deen of Allah will be rewarded the reward of 50 of the righteous ones of you. So one of them said, Ya Rasulullah, what did you say? Those who will come later, hundreds of years later, and they will be facing a lot of temptations, a lot of obstacles, a lot of fitan, because one of them will be righteous and practicing the deen of Allah, Allah will reward him the reward of 50 of us or of them. He said, rather 50 of you. They said, how come? Because the Quran admired the Sahaba, Muhajirin and Ansar, and Allah said they are the best. رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه. And in ayah number 100 of Surah At-Tawbah, chapter number 9, Allah the Almighty declared that السابقين الأولين من المهاجرين والأنصار السابقون الأولون من المهاجرين والأنصار the former order of the مهاجرين والأنصار and التابعين والذين تبعوهم بإحسان رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه. Allah is pleased with them. They are pleased with him. أعد لهم, and he has prepared for them gardens beneath which rivers are flowing, and indeed that is the ultimate success. ذلك الفوز العظيم. But now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying that there could be one of us, or 10, or 20, or 100, or more in this masjid. The reward is similar to the reward of 50 of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the best of the best. They said, how come? So he said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إِنَّكُمْ تَجِدُونَ عَلَى الْخَيْرِ أَعْوَانًا وَلَا يَجِدُونَ. That is because I'm living among you. You have people to help you to do what is good, to encourage you to be obedient. But at that time, they don't have anyone around. They will be facing the challenges by themselves. Because of that, Allah will augment the reward. So rejoice. We rejoice in the beginning with the good news. When the Prophet ﷺ said to the Bedouin, أَنْتَ مَعَ مَنْ أَحْبَبْتُ. You will be in the company of those whom you love. And now we conclude by saying, rejoice, because for mere committing yourself to practice even the basic ordainment, the 5 daily prayers, to the best of your ability in the masjid, you recite on a daily basis a few pages of the Quran, MashaAllah, besides Ramadan, you fast Mondays and Thursdays. You lower your gaze. There are a lot of fitan here. You abstain from selling what is forbidden, even though it's a booming business. But haram is haram. I'm not going to eat from haram. I'm not going to feed my family from haram. MashaAllah. Then your reward is similar to the reward of 50 of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. والله لا يضيع أجر من أحسن عملا. Brothers and sisters, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to travel abroad, and he walked on foot for 60 kilometers in order to give da'wah. In your city, Allah is bringing the whole world unto you, and you have an easy access to give them da'wah. You really want to secure a place in Al-Firdaus Al-A'la? Listen carefully. الدال على الخير كفاعله. Listen carefully. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever guides somebody to something good, then he acts upon it, he will be rewarded, and the person who has guided him shall receive a similar reward without diminishing the reward of either one of them. لأن يهدي الله بك رجلا واحدا خير لك من الدنيا وما فيها. Imagine if Allah guides through you one single tourist, one single person, that is better for you better than the entire world and what it contains. This person, every time he prays, he will be rewarded. He receive a similar reward. You're long time dead, but he's praying, you're rewarded. He's reading Quran, you're rewarded. He married a Muslim woman and have a good offspring, you're rewarded. Continuous reward. Why? Because Allah have utilized you to guide somebody. And this is a sign that Allah loves you. Because in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا أَحَبَّ عَبْدًا إِسْتَعْمَلَهُ. Whenever Allah loves one of his servants, he will utilize him or her. They said, Ya Rasulullah, what does it mean that Allah will utilize somebody, will use somebody? What does it mean? Does Allah need anybody's help? No, he said, no. Allah will guide him to a good deed, that he will do it and he will continue to do it until he dies in this condition. One of the greatest means of steadfastness, especially nowadays, is to pass on the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to others. Each and every one of us, no matter how old are you, what is your gender, we're all the messengers of the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Every tourist come here should go back with something that will benefit them. If they don't take shahada right on the spot, later on, they will take shahada because of you, because of any of the sisters. Trust me, this is a business that you need to sign up in with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by the end, because mashallah, my colleagues are here already, and we're going to enjoy listening to them as well. Allahumma ahdina. وَهْدِ بِنَا وَاجْعَلْنَا سَبَبًا لِمَنْ اهْتَدَى. Oh Allah, guide us and keep us rightly guided and utilize us to guide others and make us a cause of guidance for others. اللهم إنا نسألك حبك وحب من يحبك وحب كل عمل يقربنا من حبك. Oh Allah, grant us your love and the love of those who love you, and the love of every deed that will make us love you. اللهم اختم لنا بخاتمة السعادة. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار. اللهم هيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا واجعلنا من عبيدك السعدة. اللهم اغفر لنا ما قدمنا وما أخرنا وما أسررنا وما أعلنا وما أنت أعلم به منا. أنت المقدم وأنت المؤخر، لا إله إلا أنت. أنت حسبنا ونعم الوكيل ونعم المولى ونعم النصير. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين، وسلام على المرسلين، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله والصحب أجمعين. Questions and answers. Okay. Ask Huda. بسم الله.
Well, thank you so much for the explanations for Dr. Muhammad Salah. And we are ready for the questions and answer sessions. We are ready for the questions and answer sessions. For the question number one is coming from Hasrun Anwar. The question is, how can we always be istiqamah, especially in this day and age where there are many deviations and not in accordance with the guidance of Islam?
طيب. Inshallah, you remind me next time, the whole lecture and the main theme will be about the means of steadfastness on the straight path. This is like a very serious topic. But in brief, somebody who adheres to the jama'ah, comes to the masjid, attends a prayer in congregation. Whenever there is an event, he or she is a part of it. They pray the nawafil on a regular basis because the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam quoted in a sound hadith, Allah says, there is nothing that my servant can do to be beloved to me better than fulfilling what I have ordained upon him. Then my servant will continue to draw nearer and nearer through offering nawafil, sunan before and after the prayers, extra fasting, extra charity, until I love him. And once I love him, Allah says, I will become his hearing, his sight, his hand. Yani, even your inner desire will not overcome you anymore because you will belong to Allah. Allah will direct you. So my advice is, you begin your morning, Fajr prayer in the sunnah before sunrise. If you can make it in the masjid, great. Otherwise, with your family at home, if you're far away from the masjid, 15 minutes recite your adhkar. 10 minutes recite your sabak and word of the Quran. MashaAllah, you have a great day. Every day a little bit of sadaqah, a little bit of charity, okay? Have good companions around you. If you have a bad peer, get rid of them as soon as possible. They will cause you to sink. And not to forget, one of the greatest means of steadfastness. What? What? And the most frequently recited dua by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was, O Allah, the one who changes the hearts, keep my heart firm on your religion.
That's all. Thank you so much for answering the questions. It is a very easy to be istiqamah by charity and also focusing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and calling ourselves to our Almighty God. And we're ready for continuing with the second questions. The second questions is coming from a servant of Allah. There is no name mentioned by her. But Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I have been suicide the last few months. Every time I have this thought, I want to take wudu and pray. I cry in my prayers and sometimes I blame Allah for all the difficulties I had. I always ask Allah to guide me into a better Muslimah. But at the same time, Allah gave me such a hard time that made me questioning Allah's love for me. Astaghfirullah. Do you mind to share with me about how to pray to Allah and let go all of my doubt about Allah's plans to my life? I'm afraid that I will be hated by Allah for everything I have done in my life. Is Allah really hate its people and stop answering prayer for these kind of people? Thank you so much.
I could barely,
to be honest, it is in Bahasa.
Okay, come on. I just wanted to hear the topic of the question. Maybe the brother or the sister was saying that I have been suicidal in the past few days or whatever. And if any person is going through depression and suicidal thoughts, this person needs counseling and needs to visit a psychiatrist immediately. You need to come forward and speak to the sheikh. Because look, Habibi, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, ما خلق الله من داء إلا وخلق له الدواء. There is no disease that exists but Allah has created for it its proper cure. Who knows it? The professional physicians, doctors. There are spiritual doctors and there are clinical doctors. Depression is not necessarily something spiritual. It could be purely clinical. You need to have medical attention. You don't say, Allah, and I've been talking to Allah. Somebody is having stomachic. We say, Alhamdulillah, put your hand and say, Bismillah, and recite the dua, Jazakallahu khairan, make ruqya. But meanwhile, the Prophet said, seek the remedy. There's a medication for it. You don't just say, I have been praying and nothing works. Well, it depends on the level of your sincerity. Alhamdulillah, wallahi, wallahi, I swear to Allah, I know of a lady from Alexandria. This sister was married to a friend of mine whom I know him from the States. Her mother was diagnosed with cancer, final stage. Okay? Then they said, chemotherapy, radiation, blah, blah, blah. She said, look, if anyway I'm dying, spare your money. Just send me for Umrah so that the last thing I will do, I'll do Umrah and I will die. They fulfilled her wish. When she performed Umrah and she heard that the Prophet ﷺ said, Zamzam lima shiriba lah, the water of Zamzam is for whatever intention you drink it with. And he said about it, it's a cure for the disease, but not for everyone. It depends on the level of trust, the level of sincerity you have. So she's been crying and making dua a lot. And when she returned, she didn't die. They went for a checkup. They run the lab work. Nothing appears to be wrong with her. All the lab work, the tumor marker, they're all negative, negative. What happened? Who was treated? Did you go to the States? No, I went to Mecca. I've done Umrah. I know that lady personally. Her daughter died and she's still living 20 years later looking after her children, subhanAllah. But the Prophet ﷺ said, all of us, you get sick, you seek the remedy. The brother or the sister who sent this question, do not keep it for yourself. You need medical attention. Come forward to the Imam, have a counseling session with him. Then he will decide whether you need to be directed to a psychiatrist or a psychologist. Maybe there is a problem needs to be solved. Otherwise, you will be haunted by this evil thought. May Allah cure you. Shafak Allah wa afak. And my colleague is here, Brother Wa'il Ibrahim. He's an amazing brother. He's very lovely. And I'm pretty certain you will enjoy and love spending time with him. As'al Allah an yujri al-haqqa ala qalbihi wa lisanih. Similarly with Mufti Mink. Jazakum Allah khairan. See you inshallah in another visit. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you so much for Dr. Salah for your amazing explanations and speech delivery in front of all of us. And ladies and gentlemen, we're about to continue the sessions with the second sessions with our second speaker that flying so far away from Australia. He is Sheikh Well Ibrahim, and he is a public speaker and also a founder of Well Academy, a global organization that dedicating to helping those, a person that's suffering from porn addictions and porn movies, also masturbating, and its damaging effects. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our second speaker, Sheikh Well Ibrahim. And to Sheikh Well Ibrahim, please yourself and time is yours.